and welcome. You are watching TVRI World's Special Dialogue. I'm Siska Becker, and I'll be your host. Indonesia has a large variety of cultural products and tourist destinations that draws both domestic and international tourist attention. Some of them have won recognition as UNESCO's World Heritage Sites, such as Borobudur Temple, the Komodo National Park, Batik Clothes, Lorenz National Park, traditional Balinese dance, and also the Southern Bukit Barisan National Park.
It is part of our responsibility to dig deeper into our country's cultural heritage so that they can be forwarded to the next generation and continuously be recognized by the international society. One of the organizations that has actively been introducing the Indonesian culture is the Indonesian Heritage Society, which was established in 1970 by 17 volunteers. Currently, the organization has more than 100 members from across the globe. The Indonesia Heritage Society is a non-profit social organization that introduces, promotes, and provides knowledge on Indonesian cultural heritage to domestic and international society as part of the efforts to preserve the Indonesian culture, which is nearly forgotten as an impact of globalization. The Indonesia Heritage Society has been organizing a number of events and activities such as tours to the museums and tourist and cultural destinations, Stadium General, and establishing learning groups to conduct research on culture, people's lives, history, and various arts from across the country. Besides directly introducing the Indonesian culture, the Indonesia Heritage Society has also been actively publishing information on cultural heritage on social media outlets and weekly e-newsletter on activities and events that it will organize so that the general public can continuously participate in those activities and events.
To talk more about Indonesia's cultural heritage to the world, we now have very special guest in the studio with us from the Indonesian Heritage Society. Let me introduce you to our special guest. First, we have Anya Robertson, president of the Indonesian Heritage Society. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having us.
We also have Marcela Rohan de Torres, member of Spouse of Head of Missions, committee member of IHS Rumahku program.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, it's a pleasure. And also we have, Anna Maria, co-chair, IHS Italian section. Hello and welcome.
Hello, thank you for hosting us.
Yes, of course, it's our pleasure. And let me just start by saying you all look very lovely today, and I feel immensely underdressed right now.
it's a batik day.
Yeah, exactly. You all look very lovely, and I'm very excited to talk more about the Indonesia Heritage Society and what it's all about. Let me start this discussion by asking you, Ms. Anya Robertson, about what is actually the Indonesian Heritage Society and how did it come into being?
Indonesian Heritage Society, commonly also known as IHS, it's a legally registered yayasan, a non-profit, and with the aim to promote and sharing knowledge and increased appreciation of Indonesia's culture. So in a nutshell, our volunteers support and assist national cultural institutions.
Okay.
We started with 17 volunteers. This goes back to 1970.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay.
But then in 1995, another organization, we take the name Indonesian Heritage Society, but we took the same activities from the Ganesha volunteers.
Okay.
And so now we have become reasonably big. From the initial 17 volunteers, we have hundreds and even reach 800 at the peak of our time.
Wow.
Yes.
800 volunteers.
800 volunteers at the peak of our time. This is pre-COVID.
Okay.
Pre-COVID time.
Right. That is
amazing. And so throughout the years, for the last 52 years, we have accumulated also many materials, research, and we run library, around 5,000 books, which is available for our community and the public as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, what are the current objectives of HIS?
The current objective is the same as the Ganesha volunteers 52 okay. years ago, which is promoting Indonesia's heritage. And we're basically continuing, but has expanded our activities. Yeah.
Okay. Mm. All right. That's very interesting. Thank you very much for your explanation. Now I want to move on to Madam Marcela Rohan de Torres, as the spouse of an ambassador.
Yeah.
Do you find it easy to share your time between your duties and as a volunteer in IHS?
Actually, it's quite difficult.
I can only imagine.
We have a lot of official duties.
Okay.
I have to follow my husband in most of them.
Okay.
But, well, we try to adapt to my husband's agenda.
Yeah.
And try to squeeze in some of our volunteering, which I like very much.
Okay.
And I think it's very necessary. So, yes, I can do both.
Okay.
Very happily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Women are best in multitasking, so
yes,
I'm sure you're doing great at it. But could you elaborate on what capacity do you do this volunteering?
My job actually for IHS is to be the connection.
Okay.
Connection between the spouses of ambassadors.
Okay.
To introduce them to IHS.
Okay.
Which is the heritage, the culture, the traditions of the country that is our host. So my task is to give them all the information,
okay.
what's going on in Indonesia as in the cultural aspect, so that all spouses can enjoy and learn more about Indonesia.
Okay, so basically you are the Madam Busy Bee.
Yeah. More or less. Yes, it's
okay.
true. It's true.
All right. But you're having fun in it, I'm sure. You
I
enjoy
love it.
All the activities.
I love it.
Okay.
It's a completely different culture to me,
yeah.
completely different to my own culture.
Yes.
I come from Argentina. So it's a very, very interesting. I'm very curious. So I'm very happy I can do this job. I can do this. Yeah.
Okay.
Very,
good
very
to
nice.
Hear. Now moving on to Ms. Anna Maria, the co-chair of IHS Italian section. When did you first hear about IHS and why did you decide to join?
Well, the first time I heard about IHS was when we were preparing our transfer to Jakarta.
Oh, okay.
So of course, my husband works for the European Union delegation. And we have some colleagues who have been here already, who have met someone, who have met someone.
Okay.
And that's how I got to know about IHS, someone who lived in Jakarta and loved IHS activities. And
okay.
they said, when you arrive there, the first thing you have to do is get a membership and you will discover Indonesia guided really by your hand. And it was really that way for me.
Okay.
It's been an amazing door to an amazing culture and made so much easier.
Okay, that's interesting. I would love to know more actually about maybe your experience as a foreigner coming to Indonesia, especially if it's your first time. Maybe you had like some preconceived notions and expectations about Indonesia that was proven to be wrong when you finally arrived here. Do you have any stories relating to that?
I don't really have a story about that because, and that's something I was very surprised
okay.
of. There is very little information and very little education about Asia in general
okay.
and Indonesia in particular. So I had some vague idea of
okay.
what it was, but I didn't even have enough knowledge to have a preconception, to be honest.
Okay.
So when we arrived here, I was raised in Colombia. It's also a tropical country.
Okay.
So I find similar ingredients, similar fruits.
Yeah.
But they are prepared in a fully different way.
Oh.
So it was like familiar, but so foreign. And yeah, it takes a little bit of time to understand the names, how they are prepared.
Okay.
And it's basically the same with all other aspects.
Okay.
Similar, but different.
Okay, that's very interesting. How about you, Madam Marcela? You mentioned before that the culture that you used to, with the Indonesian culture is quite different, to say the least, right?
Absolutely different.
How did you adjust to it, and how did you become enamored by it to the point where you want to also promote it to many people?
I love countries with traditions. Okay. I love countries that promote the traditions, that are proud of their traditions, that show their traditions to the world. So I think that's the best thing to do is to help them do that, because it is, in particular with Indonesia, you have so many things to offer, to show, and people don't know about Indonesia that much. So your food, your textiles, your language, your traditions, your everything is the geography.
Okay.
The geography is amazing. Everywhere you go, you are amazed by such forests and animals and the wild aspect of Indonesia, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
The volcanoes. Never-ending.
Yeah. You have everything
to volcanoes,
yes.
And so it is such a big variety. And I must say, the hospitality.
Mm,
hospitality. Okay. We feel very welcome as foreigners in Indonesia. Yeah. People are very generous. People open their homes to us. People want to share their food with us. Their traditions, their prayers, their everything.
Yeah.
It is like they want, that's why I say it, people are very proud of their country.
Yeah.
And I love that. I really like that.
Wow, that's very encouraging to hear. Thank you so much.
As an Indonesian, that's wonderful to hear.
Yeah, that's very wonderful. And I agree, we are actually a very open and welcoming country, which I suppose would be very hard for IHS in the pandemic area, because you cannot be as open as you want to be, especially to volunteers. As you said, you had at the peak of the organization 800 volunteers,
but that was pre-pandemic.
How was the pandemic era for IHS?
The pandemic shocked everyone, including us, of course, and when it happened, we thought, oh, it's not going to last very long, but in fact it did. And so we had to do something. We had to keep engaging with our community.
Yeah.
And so the first thing we did, okay, we worked with our IT experts and so on, when we did our first Zoom.
Yeah.
And we discussed Pramudya Anantatur in our literature group.
Okay.
And it turned out a big success, because we could connect with our former members in Japan, in France, in Australia.
Yeah.
And it was really like, wow, you know, dynamic. So in one sense, that it was really a blessing in disguise, because then we could also connect with academics in other countries and people also outside Jakarta.
Okay.
So for us, this is what we wanted to do, to promote, you know. And so we did really several interesting programs on the Diponegoro, invited experts from Leiden University and from Museum Nasional, an expert in Jakarta. So it was an eye-opening in one sense for us.
And that was done online?
It was all done online.
Oh, wow.
We survived for 2 years online.
Okay.
And then that way we managed to keep our community engaged and continuously curating programs and so on, and expanding.
Okay.
And in fact, we are just starting a new program based in Italy called GMT, Greenwich Mean Time Study Group.
Okay.
And this week we started with the title Bhinneka Tunggal Ika.
Nice.
So we have in fact expanded as a result of, you know, so there is this other side that we actually have benefit. Yeah.
There's a silver lining.
There's a silver lining, definitely. Yeah, exactly.
Now that we are in the post-pandemic era, how do you promote Indonesia's cultural heritage to your community and other people? And maybe could you also outline some of IHS main activities right now in 2022 and beyond?
Yes, IHS has been around for 52 years. So we have, our activities have been really grown, wide ranging. And as a result of that, we have to have a good structure for our activities. Okay. And the museum section division, for example, we concentrate on all museums around Jakarta, and we work very closely with Museum Nasional offering tours, museum tours, to the public as well as special requests. So we do at least 16 tours in a month, in addition, of course, the special request. And we also do museum training to equip ourselves with knowledge, and very intensive 3 months museum training conducted by our mentor, IHS guides, and as well as Museum Nasional curator. And we also assist Museum Nasional in their exhibitions and their big exhibition. And the other section, so there are two sections that are our focus for activities. The other section is the community, and it's divided with lectures, that is Rumaku, evening lecture, and in study groups, many, many studies in small groups on topics like Borobudur or Wallace Line. And then we have tours, we have explorers.
Yeah.
And I would recommend that for someone who just arrived in Jakarta, then you will find out all the nooks and crannies about Jakarta there from joining the explorer group. So that's really excellent. They do about 15 tours a month.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So quite productive.
Very, very productive, very, very popular.
Okay. And always full.
Always full. And they have to repeat.
Yeah.
Tours again, somewhere another date or in the afternoon or in the weekend.
Okay. Yeah. Because of the huge interest of people to join.
Yes, really overwhelmingly. Oh, and then we divide the section with Petruk, Garen group, Arjuna group.
I love the names.
Yeah. Okay. Really fun.
Okay.
And then we do another tour, which is more serious, much more extensive, around Indonesia. We do around about six tours in a year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so, and the rest of the community division, we have the language sections. Five language sections, and one of the language section is headed by Anna Maria.
Ah, okay, yeah. Interesting.
So that's in the gist of our activity.
Okay, the general explanation. I'm sure there's a lot of
More details. Okay, and but we divide it into sections, and just to make sure that it doesn't overlap.
Yeah. I would like to dive deeper into the activities and also a little bit about Rumahku. But first, I want to talk more about Indonesia's tourist destinations, especially to our viewers. Indonesia is renowned for having various best tourist destinations in the world, either natural or man-made ones. Of those tourist destinations, 14 of which are already recognized by the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, or UNESCO, as UNESCO World Heritage Sites, ranging from temple until batik clothes. The following are the details. Welcome back to the special dialogue program where we're talking with guests from the Indonesian Heritage Society. Now let's continue our chat, ladies. Like I said before, I would love to know more about Rumahku. Madam Marcella, can you explain more? What does Rumahku mean?
Rumahku is a very small activity within IHS. There are many other activities you have heard about, and Rumahku takes place once a month.
Okay.
It's an event that takes place in the home of an ambassador in general.
Okay.
It is an event where we invite a specific speaker connected with the Indonesian culture. That speaker might be an artist, a writer, a painter, a businessman, or someone who can bring to us some knowledge about Indonesia. So up to now, this has been very popular, and we even try to hold these meetings at traditional Indonesian homes so that we get to know how the Indonesians live, what a traditional home it is, what the food also is very important.
Okay.
And most of these people transmit through their profession, not the knowledge of the, maybe of how they paint or what is the kind of design they prefer, or the evolution of fashion, for example. We had fashion designers also.
Nice.
We had the CEO of a very, very well-known coffee store, and he could introduce us to the coffee business here, which is so important and so interesting. And we got to know a lot about coffee. And we even had the possibility to try all the different coffee from all different areas here. So that was very, very interesting for us, no?
Otherwise, were you a coffee drinker to begin with?
I am.
Are you a coffee? Oh, yes. That must have been really exciting.
I love it. I love espresso to Italian origins. But actually, we got to know that 80% of the coffee that is sold in the world comes from Sumatra.
Yes, it's true.
So, well, you have to be proud, no?
Yeah.
And then
you're in the center of coffee in the world when you're in Indonesia.
Yeah. Coffee plantations, tobacco plantations. We also had opportunity about tobacco.
Okay.
So really very, that is what Rumahku is about.
Okay. Now, how do you decide on the speakers that you invite to
the sessions? That's quite difficult. I don't do that because I am not native to Indonesia. So within our ISI board in the Rumahku, there are some Indonesian ladies who interview some prominent professional in some area, and so they try to organize these interviews, speakings.
And what about the audience, the participants?
Well, actually this was aimed to expats, people who are come from abroad, and to help them and understand more about the culture of Indonesia. But this has become so popular that we have a lot of Indonesians in the group also.
Okay,
yeah.
It's a very interesting and fun way to get new perspectives about Indonesia, I'm sure. That's why it's very popular.
Yes, yes, and for us, it's we are very proud because it takes a long time to try to organize the date, the home, that has to be available, and the speaker who has to be in Jakarta for that time, a nice speaker also. We need to have someone who is entertaining and can attract the audience. And so it is a difficult task. But it's very, very popular.
We appreciate it. It's very, very popular. And people wait for it. When is the next Rumaku? When is the next Rumaku?
Yes.
Very sought after, yeah?
There is also the surprise. You don't know beforehand where it will be.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So every time it's a different residence, it's a surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think that's very well taught.
Yes, we just say who is going to speak, who is the guest we're going to have, but not the venue.
Oh, I see. So the location.
It's last minute.
It's last
secret.
Minute.
Secret.
It's a secret. Secret location. I love that. Intriguing. Yeah. Always pique the interest
because
more, right?
We try that people get interested in the subject.
Okay.
Not in the place.
Mm, yeah, that's true. That's true. Now moving on to Ms. Ana Maria, you mentioned that you focus on more language-focused activities in the organization. Now, could you tell more about that experience? How was it like learning more about the Indonesian language and talking to people about how to communicate more using the language?
There is a slightly different approach to language.
Okay.
So we get a lot from Indonesia. But we also need to fall back to our native language sometimes.
Mm, okay.
So these language sections are actually foreign language sections.
Okay.
So that would be Chinese, Korean, Italian, French. Am I forgetting one?
No, I think it covers
the
about
five of them.
Okay.
So what we do is to promote Indonesian Heritage Society and the Indonesian culture and heritage in the community of expats from our language. We would like to expand and not call it the Italian section or the French section, but the Italian speaking section.
Yeah.
And there as well, we get a lot of Indonesians who have been living abroad, who may be studying in Italy and want to practice their Italian while learning more about their own country.
Okay.
So it's a really nice place to meet each other, both Indonesian and expats. Although the activities we do to keep our community together range from a batik workshop, for example, to introduce batik, but while doing something. So we would try ourselves batik tulis or different activities. We'd try cooking or doing jamu.
Yeah.
So it would be a nice moment to share together, not to be alone in a country where you don't know anyone when you arrive, and at the same time discover the culture.
Okay. Have you had the chance actually to learn more about how to use the language actively, Indonesian? The reason
Indonesian.
I ask, because I always wonder, when it comes to us Indonesian learning foreign native tongues, it's quite hard because of the grammar, because of how to pronounce words. Where Indonesia, we always see our language is so easy to learn. But is it so?
No, everyone says that, and I don't know why. Because maybe because you don't have a conjugation or so many words in that sense to memorize, but you have plenty of other words that we have to learn as a foreigner. And it's not easy. I don't find it easy to be able to communicate. So my Indonesian is still very, very basic. And it's I think it's a bad assumption to say that it's easy, because it's a complex language with the roots from Sanskrit, from Arab, from Malay.
Yeah.
So it's a very interesting language indeed. We are planning actually a talk with an Italian scholar who is specialized in Indonesian language.
Okay.
So she teaches Indonesian in the University of Naples.
Okay.
And she's happy to join. We have to see the details, either via Zoom, because now we're used to it, we can use it at our advantage. Or if she can come one of the days, she's traveling to Jakarta to talk about Indonesian language compared to Italian language and how she sees Italian people learning Indonesia there. So it's very interesting.
Comparative studies between languages, that's interesting.
Actually, during the pandemic, we tried to organize sort of coffee morning, in Zoom coffee morning, in Indonesian conversation.
Yes.
And we thought that would be the best way
to practice.
You know, by immersion, to familiarize with the words and in a more relaxing atmosphere. And we stopped that during the pandemic because it's a bit difficult not to see faces, you know. So I think we will start again. I think that will be a lot of interest.
I'll be able to practice
coffee
a little.
Morning. Yeah.
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 Over Sumatran coffee, I presume.
Exactly, Sumatran coffee. Sure. Mandailing. Yeah, that will be fun.
That sounds lovely. Yeah. Okay, now next I want to talk more about your personal experiences enjoying the beauty of Indonesia. But before that, let's take a little break before we proceed with our chat. Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back right here on Special Dialogue. Back on Special Dialogue with my lovely guest from the Indonesian Heritage Society. Now, we were just chatting about how all of you enjoy different aspects of Indonesia's culture. Now, Ms. Anya, maybe you can explain, how did you first come about with the concept of promoting and introducing the Indonesian culture? Because there's so many aspects of it, right? There's the music, there's the performances, there's the language, there's the dances. How do you formalize the concept to introduce it for the first time to a foreigner, for instance?
Well, because IHS, I'm taking over IHS, and it was already ready with all the different sections and the program. So we continue that. And we make sure that the program doesn't overlap. For one thing, the museum guiding tour, it covers just about the whole aspects of Indonesia, music, wayang, batik, it's just very comprehensive. And so for us to give a museum guiding courses, for example, to be a museum guide, it's one way for our volunteers to learn and at the same time contributing the knowledge, passing it on to the public. And then when our volunteers go home, they have all this knowledge and they come back to us and then they keep contributing. For example, we have someone who has moved to India and she is an expert in Hindu statues. So she continues guiding with her friend in the Museum National with a portable telephone showing her the statues. And with another phone, she does her guiding. And to me, that is just the height of volunteering, you know. And another person in New Zealand, and she helped organizing the daily museum tours. So she has moved, but then she keeps doing this, and it's amazing. So I think that with Area Heritage Society, we have perhaps, if I may say so, succeeded embedding this love of culture of Indonesia, that it stays with the volunteers, and that is one way. Yes,
it's very interesting. Madam Marcela, could you tell us maybe your first experience where you first was exposed to Indonesian culture and you first fell in love with it? Can you remember?
Oh yes,
the moment.
First, when I arrived, immediately.
Really?
Oh, okay. Almost immediately, because as spouse of ambassadors, you are welcome in a very, very formal way. And so you are immediately surrounded by local Indonesians who try to invite you to their traditions, to their homes, to participate in their daily life, no? And so I was really attracted to that. And as spouse of ambassador, we don't have many opportunities to mingle with in the everyday Indonesian life. So this for me was a very good opportunity to make friends, Indonesian friends. Otherwise, I keep staying in a bubble with a diplomatic group. So there isn't much chance to speak Indonesian Bahasa okay. Indonesia, which yeah. I don't speak very well.
Okay.
But and at the same time, get to know other Indonesians, no?
Yeah.
That are, do not belong to the diplomatic group.
Okay.
So that's why this for me was very easy personally, no?
Okay.
To
yes.
get in touch with Indonesian people. So that's why I said I have to do this. I have to volunteer because it's the best way to maybe give back into Indonesia what the host country is giving us.
Oh, that's wonderful. So it's a great way to expand your network for sure.
Absolutely.
And also to expand your knowledge about this huge country. Have you had a chance though to travel to
yes.
many places in Indonesia?
Actually,
what has been your favorite
we arrived
so far?
Here 3 years ago.
Okay.
So before COVID. So we had like 6 months to travel.
Oh, that's nice.
And freely. And really we enjoyed a lot. Indonesia, we traveled
yeah.
within Indonesia. I don't think you can ever visit everything, all the
yeah.
islands, all the places. Even when you go to one place and come back and people say, did you go to the, oh no, I missed that volcano or I missed the lake
yeah.
or
yeah.
no, it is just like that, no? But yes, we traveled extensively.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have around 17,000 islands, if I'm not mistaken,
in
Indonesia.
Yeah, and
even if you visit one island each a day, it'll
yeah.
take you hundreds of years to do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's the fourth largest archipelago
yeah.
in the world. It's just, it's a huge body of water there to cross.
It's true. How about you, Miss Anna Maria? Have you had a chance to travel around Indonesia?
Yes, we've been... We were discussing this just before because I arrived just during the pandemics.
Okay.
So it was a very special occasion to travel in Indonesia without the tourists.
Yes.
There was no visa issuing, so we were super lucky to go to Bali.
Oh, nice.
And there were only local tourists.
Okay.
And it was really special for us to be, it felt really like a privilege to discover the country without so many people because Indonesia is a very popular destination, in particular
yeah.
Bali. And we also went to Lombok and Belitung and scuba diving, snorkeling.
Yeah.
The biodiversity is so impressive.
Yes, beautiful destinations you just mentioned there. And a lot of people who have visited Indonesia and got the chance to travel it all said that the thing that surprised them the most is how varied the cultures are.
Yes.
Even like in one island alone, let's say Java, there's so many different cultures
yes.
and languages. Was that your impression as well when you traveled?
Definitely. You don't have to go very far to
yeah.
see these differences. So just if you have to go to Yogyakarta, which mm-hmm. is another beautiful destination, you visit Borobudur, you learn about the Buddhist culture, and then you visit Prambanan and the Hindu, and how all these things are mixed with Islam and Java
yeah.
people. And it's at the very beginning, it's a bit difficult to place everyone.
Yeah. Quite overwhelming.
Quite overwhelming. But I am following the museum guide training.
Okay.
And it's really, I think I have participated in so many activities organized by the IHS. And this way of studying and really getting in depth into the subject, into the geography, into the tectonic plates, it's really a broad understanding of the country that allows me to see how history shaped the country today.
Okay.
And it's fascinating.
Yeah.
And I think I will bring that with me
yeah.
and never forget.
Even our tours around Indonesia, it's not just tourism. Each person who participated in our tour, they do a little bit of research. On different aspects of the place they visit,
okay.
architecture or religion or food. So by the end of it, then you get the whole global picture about the place
yes.
You visit, which is
you get a comprehensive perspective.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's so much more enriching than just
yeah.
go and see the beach
yeah.
or see a museum and you don't really understand.
The textiles, I mean the songkets, they're just all throughout the country, all
yeah.
the different, you know, methods of creating it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
you get more contacts and you get more of the feel of the people as well.
Yeah, exactly.
When you
yeah.
study the history and
yeah.
the culture.
Yeah.
Now, with your experiences as a language enthusiast and history enthusiast, and with all the activities you've done with IHS, I just want to ask you, if you have to choose one of a particular Indonesian culture, or maybe like an aspect of it, which one would be your favorite? Maybe Madam Marcella?
Fashion.
Fashion, I love it. Without thinking.
I love it, yeah. I love batik.
Oh, okay.
I love how you work with batik. Your textiles are amazing.
Yes.
Each region has their own batik.
Yes.
The ulos, I fell in love with the ulos mm-hmm. in the Lake Toba.
Yeah.
The colors, the dyeing with yeah. Natural colors, how you treat the cotton, the silk.
Okay.
Absolutely, it's amazing. You don't
yes.
need a fantastic design to make a beautiful
yeah.
dress. Just the textile,
yeah.
the batik. Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah.
yeah.
So it's
the thing
beautiful.
The thing with traditional Indonesian textiles, it's more like a way of life. It tells the stories of the people.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
you wear it from yeah. the moment you were born, even until
yeah.
you die.
Yes.
So it is very integral part yeah. of the culture.
Each design has yeah. some meaning.
A meaning.
Some,
that's
yeah.
why.
Yeah.
Once I said, oh, yeah, that's beautiful design. Oh, I shouldn't be wearing this because it's this for a king. It should be worn by the king. Oh, okay. So
yeah.
I know now
yeah, yeah,
what
yeah.
I cannot wear.
Yeah.
So, but it's amazing. No?
Yeah,
how can
yeah.
you discover where
okay.
the person comes from
yeah.
through their batik?
Mm-hmm.
No?
Yes.
It is beautiful. And I find the kebaya so feminine.
Yeah.
So sexy, so nice, feminine. Actually, it is really yeah. a nice garment to wear. So, in
oh,
many different.
You've worn the kebaya yourself.
Did.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, I would love to see you in that. It must look amazing.
I wore kebaya, I wore the sarong, and
oh,
yeah,
okay.
yes,
yeah.
everything. I love it. I really like it. Very
I
much.
Could truly feel your. Passion for Indonesian fashion just now when you speak of it, but I'm sure that is one of the most popular activities.
It is.
In IHS.
Textile is very, very popular. Mm. We work very closely with Textile Museum,
okay.
and we do inventory. We recommend how to preserve them. We don't claim we're experts. We invite experts
okay.
and we learn from them, and we do it together
okay.
with the museum textile people.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then of course we have always talks on textile.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, hundreds of it could
yeah.
be Ikats and you know Java and Songket and,
yeah.
and so on. Even now as Indonesian, I'm still learning about it. I'm still
yeah.
enthusiastic about it.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, there's so much to discover.
Yeah, it's a never-ending endeavor.
It is. And there's a lot of IHS to grow.
Okay.
Because there's just so much to learn.
There is. How about you, Ms. Ana Maria? What is the one thing about Indonesian culture that you would talk to your friends back home, for instance?
So this is something I would like to explore more with the Indonesian Heritage
okay.
Society. The art scene, contemporary
oh.
art,
okay.
painting, photography, sculpture.
Oh, that's interesting.
I think it's extremely rich. It's
yeah.
very dynamic. Despite COVID,
yeah.
I've been to Art Jakarta, it's a fantastic fair,
yeah.
and Indonesian artists are so talented. So this is something that I really enjoy,
okay.
visiting the galleries, visiting art spaces. Galnas, for example, is a very
yeah.
good museum to go for temporary exhibitions as well,
yeah.
On top of the permanent collection. And yeah, I think there is a really a lot of talent.
Yeah.
And a lot of artists, contemporary artists working also on textile.
Yes.
They weave themselves either with a recycled material or print photography on top of what they have woven. So it's I think textile is a very prevalent topic, but you have also all sort of contemporary artists working in different media, and it's very, very interesting.
Yeah. That is actually a fantastic idea, because art is universal, and
yes.
it'll be a great way of communication between all of the countries in the world. through the art of Indonesian.
Right? And it's very vibrant. The art activities world here in Jakarta and Jogja is very, very vibrant now.
Okay, now we're going to talk more about your future events, but before that, let's take a little break first, ladies.
Thank you.
Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back. We've had the loveliest discussion so far with the Indonesian Heritage Society, and now our talk is coming to an end. But before that, I would love to talk more with Madam Anya Robertson about future events of the IHS and maybe future plans that you can share with us.
Oh, we have just so many future events. I can't remember them all, but for example, next week we will have environmental activist who has written a book about slavery. Indonesian was sent to Africa. That was a book launch. And then we will have from the night study group, the indigo dye. We are very much into natural dye. Okay. So we will have a talk on that. And then we will have, we had a very interesting talk on Bali, the last 50 years of Bali by Jean Couteau. Very, very interesting to see here the development of Bali. And in literature, we're going to talk about, I think we have done Pramudia. We've done most of the Indonesian writers that have been translated to English. Next week we have a series of, so every year we have series of writers that we will do, so every month we just, because it takes a long time to read books,
of course.
We have to have the list in advance. But trips, for example, to Bali, so now that we're opening up, we have trips coming up with Udayana professor and visiting all the historical sites. What else is there? I can't remember the language groups.
Yes, the language. We're not going so far, but we are organizing for the Italian speaking community workshops on dot painting, and in the few coming months, batik. But our community is also very interested in environment and natural heritage. So we're also planning a visit to the Bogor Botanical Garden, for example. And I know there is interest in a few organic farms around Bogor, where you can see the plants that sometimes we don't know and cook them, learn how to cook them the Indonesian way. So those are the few plans we have for this year.
Yes.
So it's basically each section has its own program. Many programs that we announce in our e-news, but each section had its own, like the language sections, the museum. Of course, now we are training, museum training time, and we also provide tours, theme tours or in-depth tours or highlight tours. So many. I just can't, I just don't know how many.
I can tell next week.
Yes.
There will be a tour to Pasar Majestic.
They must be explorer
to be to see of the textiles that are available there.
And then another pasar, the Pasar Baru. Another tour. Another tour would be to the Monas, the cathedral. Catholic cathedral. The mosque. Another tour.
Opposite.
Yes, opposite there is a tunnel connecting them. I heard.
Is it open now? Because I heard it was in construction. Is it open?
The tunnel?
Let me know.
The tour
is
on.
Well.
They are offering to go through the tunnel, so I suppose so.
Yeah.
Yes.
We also do culinary visits. So we visit Indonesian restaurants.
Oh, wow.
That is traditional food.
That must be really popular because nothing gets people more happy than good food, right?
Yeah. So now we're really going also to focus on this. This is part of our new activities start also inviting chef and to cook. We had really Pak Bongso one time, so we're going to focus more also on that. Indonesian drinks also, traditional drinks. And yeah, there are many, many more to go to.
So busy months ahead, in the end of 2022.
Yeah, this is going to be a very busy year because we're just coming out of COVID and everyone is just come out with fresh ideas.
And I'm sure that people watching now who are getting more interest in Indonesian Heritage Society would love to know how to be a part of it. Maybe not just as participants, but as volunteers, or maybe as speakers for many sessions from the IHS?
Well, basically, we call ourselves Friends of Indonesian Heritage.
Okay.
So as friends, we register once a year.
Okay.
And basically, then you are a volunteer.
Okay.
And a volunteer, you can come up with idea. For example, I would like to set up, to study Borobudur. Mm-hmm. And then you find, minimum enough people to do research. And then each of us has to do a presentation on a study. And you can make it bigger and bigger. And then another person is interested in textile. I want to do research on ikat or double ikat, for example. And then you do a research.
Okay.
So the program of IHS is initiated by the volunteers. Conducted and executed by the volunteers, enjoyed by the volunteers. So we're really very open to ideas.
Okay.
Yeah, there is no, and if you want to assume more responsibilities, we announce like we have opening for co-chairs, we have opening for vice presidents, and so on. So it's really up to the individuals how far you want to go or how much more responsibilities you want to take. Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting. I'm sure people will be looking up Indonesian Heritage Society online after this.
Okay, you're welcome.
How about the focus on which Indonesian heritage will be more focused on the upcoming year? Is there a certain part of Indonesian heritage that will be more of a focus?
Well, we will continue with our traditional activities. And we will adding activities. For example, now after the pandemic, we know how to do, we're familiar with the digital, with Zoom, for example.
Okay.
And that gives idea for volunteers who go home and to set up another group.
Okay.
So we have now group in Europe, we have group in Japan.
Yeah.
And we hope that there will be more groups and with, and we can communicate. That's the wonderful thing about it. We can still see face to face, and then we can always help with materials, with research, and so on. And we can still guide by the phone. So the opportunity is huge.
Yeah.
And as you say, you didn't hear much about Asia, and that's just a lot more work again for us to promote.
But you're forming ambassadors.
Yeah,
and that's
official ambassadors.
How I heard about Indonesian Heritage Society. It's someone who fell in love with Indonesian culture through this association.
Okay.
And because you make so many good friends as well, it's very easy to stay in touch.
And
it's really
beautiful. Not unusual. Sorry, it's not unusual you meet our volunteers 20 years, 30 years of IHS.
Yeah.
And they are also become reference for our volunteers. So it's like a lifetime friendship.
Okay, yeah. So that is how you promote Indonesian culture, Indonesian heritage, basically, by forming these friendships, uniting with people with the same passion and dedication to Indonesian culture and tradition.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, you have mentioned before that you would love to explore the Indonesian contemporary art scene more. Maybe, Madam Marcella, if you could choose which aspect of the Indonesian culture and tradition you would want to explore more in the coming year, what would be your choice?
Maybe food.
food, yes.
Maybe
I
food.
I love that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Which Indonesian cuisine have been your most favorite so far?
Actually, it's been very difficult because of the chili.
Oh, is it? Oh,
the
okay.
chili invades my mouth and disrupts all other
flavors.
Yeah, but actually, you have so many fantastic, tasty dishes.
Yes.
Again, in many areas, wherever you go, you have a different dish. There is no signature Indonesian dish.
No, there's too many of them. Right?
Yes. So I would like to know more about food. Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
that could be also an idea for an activity. Maybe you can have like a cook-off between Indonesian chefs to recreate spicy Indonesian food, but make it less spicy, Madam Ambassador.
Right? Less chili.
Yes. But on the other hand, we also have the Javanese with lots of sugar.
Sweet dishes.
Yes.
And I have to ask them, please, less sweet because I'm from Sumatra.
Oh, okay. So different palate altogether. Yeah, different people, different palate.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, to conclude our chat, I would love to hear from each and every one of you your hopes and wishes for Indonesian culture, Indonesian heritage, and also for your organization to promote these beautiful culture and traditions as well.
For Indonesian Heritage Society, I'm very enthusiastic because I see that the regeneration is taking process, I think, now. There are more and more Indonesian joining Indonesian Heritage, which was new. So there is that aspect. And there's so much to learn, to discover. And then, for example, when I do guide, I'm on an active guide at Museum Nasional, and I see busloads of young children visit the museum. And to me, that is amazing. That is that's the future.
Yeah.
That's the future of Indonesia's culture. And they do research. They're so busy looking and writing. As an Indonesian, to me, it's fantastic. And to promote Indonesian culture, you know, we now that we know join the digital world, there is a big hope for us also to expand through our volunteers, through our unofficial ambassador, and our ambassador.
That's wonderful. Mm. I'm sure that's all of our wishes, actually, to have people more actively participating in preserving the beautiful culture and tradition, and also the history. How about you, Madam Marcela?
I wish that everybody in the world knew about more about Indonesia, what Indonesia is about the people. Mm. People are very special, very, very hospitable, very generous, and eager to share their country. So I wish most expats, diplomats who come here for a short time, actually we are here for a very short time, so IHS is a great place to start and to learn more about Indonesia. So thank I really you. Recommend to join, really.
Thank you, Madam Marcela. I hope more people are like you, who fell in love with Indonesia and are actively pursuing the promotion of it, so many more people would love to come here and experience it for themselves.
I really hope so.
Thank you.
Ms. Ana Maria, what are your hopes and wishes?
Hopes and wishes. Well, I wish the Indonesian Heritage Society a long life.
Yes, it's here.
Yeah, it's not a young institution, but I hope it will live many more years. And I also wish that the Indonesian heritage and culture can be more known in the world, can be brought to other countries and explained to other people, because it's very valuable and it's so beautiful.
All right. Thank you so much, ladies, for coming to our studio today. Thank you for inspiring us with your passion and dedication to Indonesian tradition and culture. I wish you all the best for your future endeavors. And hopefully we can meet again in other future events, both in TVRI and at IHS. would love to see you again.
Please
talk
join
more
us.
About
please,
you'll be very happy.
You're very welcome to join us.
Oh, I would love to. And that the cook-off. I would love to see that happening. Please invite me if it does.
Okay,
good. Thank
project.
You so much, ladies.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yes.
And that's the end of our special dialogue with Indonesian Heritage Society. I'm Siska Becker. Thank you for watching and goodbye.